Learn Excel from Mr. Excel podcast, episode 2016, top-down budget versus bottom-up actuals. Hey, I'm podcasting this entire book. Click that I in the top right-hand corner and follow the playlist. Hey, I'm going to interrupt this. This is Bill Jelen from 15 minutes from now. I realize now this is an incredibly long podcast and you're tempted just to click right through it. But let me just give you the short of it. If you're in Excel 2013 and you've ever had a small budget table and a massive actuals table, and you need to map them together. This is an amazing new ability that we have in Excel 2013 that not many people have explained, and you probably don't know about it. If this is you, you're in 2013, and you need to map these two data sets, take the time, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, maybe add it to the watch list. It's worth it. It's an amazing technique. All right, here's what we have. On the left-hand side, we have a budget. This budget is done at the top level, top down, right? For each product line, for each region, for each month, there's a budget. Not many records here, count of 55. On the right-hand side, we're trying to compare this to actuals. The actuals are coming from an invoice register. So we have region, product, and revenue, but they're individual invoices. A lot more data here. We're only halfway through the year and already have 423 records, all right? So how do you map these 55 to these 423? Well, it'd be tough to do with VLOOKUP. You'd have to summarize first, but thankfully in Excel 2013, the data model makes this really, really easy. What we need to allow this big, massive table to communicate with this tiny table are intermediaries. I call them joiners. Tiny little tables, product, region, and calendar. We're going to join the budget to these three tables, we're going to join the actual to these three tables, and miraculously the pivot table will work. All right, so here's how we do that. First off, I need to create the joiners. So I take this product field from column A and I copy it over to column F, and then data, remove duplicates, click OK, and we're left with a tiny little table, one heading, three rows. Same thing for region. Take the regions, control C, go over to column G, paste, remove duplicates, click OK, three rows, one header. All right, now for the dates. The dates are not the same. These are month ending dates. They're actually stored as month ending dates, and these are weekdays. So I'm going to take both lists, control C, the second list, and paste it here, control V. Then I'm going to take the shorter list, copy that, and paste it down below. All right, and it's really annoying that even though these are stored as dates, they're appearing as months, and remove duplicates won't see them as the same. So before I use remove duplicates, I have to change it to a short date. Choose that data, data, remove duplicates, click OK, and then a little sort here to get it to work. All right, now I don't want to report by daily date, so I'm going to add a column here, a lookup column that says month, and this will be equal EO month of that date, comma, zero, which will get us out to the end of the month. Again, we'll format that as a short date and copy that down. All right, now we need to make each of these into a control T table. So from here, control T, my table has headers, beautiful. The small ones, it doesn't realize those are headers up there, so we have to make sure to check mark that. T, all right, and they call these tables table 1, table 2, table 3, really boring names, right? So I'm going to rename these and call it the bud table, the prod table, reach table, my calendar table, and then the actuals table. All right, we start from the very first table. And by the way, we're not going to use PowerPivot today. We're going to do all this with the data model. So Excel 2013 or newer, you have this insert pivot table. We're going to check the box for add this data to the data model. Click OK. And we get our field list with the magic all button that lets me choose from all five tables in the workbook. Actual, budget, calendar, product, region. All right, so the numbers are going to come from the budget table. I'll put the budget in there. And from the actual table, I'll put the actual in there. But then here's the thing, for the rest of the pivot table, any other text fields that we're going to put in the row area or the column area or as slicers, they have to come from the joiners. They have to come from those tables between the tables. All right, so from the calendar table, we'll take that month field and put it across the top. We're going to ignore the relationships right now. I will be creating the relationships, but I want to create them all at once. And the region table, I'll put regions down the side. I could put products down the side, but I'm actually going to use the product table as a slicer. So analyze, insert slicer. Again, you have to go to all. So yeah, I haven't used the product table yet. So go to all, and you'll see that the product is available. We'll create a slicer from the products like that. All right, now at this point, we haven't created relationships, so all of these numbers are wrong. And the relationships we have to create three tables from this little budget table, one to the products, one to regions, one to calendar. That's three relationships. And then we have to create relationships from the actual table to the product, region, and calendar. So a total of six tables. And yes, this would definitely be easier if we had PowerPivot, but we don't, or let's assume we don't. And so I'm going to use the old-fashioned way, the create dialog here, where we have the budget table on the left, and we're going to use the region field and relate that to the region table, the region field. All right, one of six are created. I'll choose create again. From the budget table, we go to the product, and then link that to the product table to the product. Click OK. From the budget table, the date field, we go to the calendar table and the date field. Click OK. We're halfway there. All right. From the actuals table, we go region to the region table. Click OK. From the actuals table, to the product, and from the actuals table to the calendar. I'm actually going to take the values and make it go down the side. All right. Design, report layout, show in tabular form to get a view that I prefer. Repeat all item labels. All right, this is absolutely amazing. Now we have this tiny little table of 50 some records and this table of hundreds of records, and we've created a single pivot table thanks to the data model for each, where we can see the budget, we can see the revenue, it's broken out by region, it's broken out by month, and it's sliceable by product. Now, this concept came to me from Rob Colley, who runs PowerPivot Pro, and Rob has created a lot of books out there. His latest one is PowerPivot and Power BI. I think this one was actually in the PowerPivot Alchemy book. It's the one that I saw this and I said, well, this, even though I don't have millions of rows to report through PowerPivot, this is one that would have made a huge difference in my life, having two data sets of mismatch sizes and needing to report from both of them. Well, this example and many others are in this book. I will eventually get the entire book podcast. It looks like it's going to take 2.5 months, but you can get the whole book today. Save time, go out there and buy the book. $10 for the ebook, $25 for the print book, and you can have all those tips at once. All right, a really long episode here. We have a small top-down budget and a bottoms-up actual. They are different sizes. But using the data model in Excel 2013, and by the way, if you're in 2010, you could, in theory, do this by getting the PowerPivot add-in and go through all these steps back in 2010. Make both data sets into a control T table, and then joiner tables for anything you want to report on in the row label, or the column label, or the slicers. So copy those values over and remove duplicates. For the dates, I actually took values from both tables because there were some unique values in each. And then I use the EO month to get out there. Make those joiner tables be control tables. It's optional, but I named all five tables because it's easier when you're setting up those relationships rather than having it be called table 1, table 2, table 3, and so on. Start from the budget table, insert pivot table, check the box for data model, and then building a pivot table using budget and actual. Everything else comes from the joiner tables, so region and month in the row and column area. slicers that came from the product table. And then we had to create three relationships from the budget to the joiners, three relationships from the actual to the joiners, and we have an amazing pivot table. Now, tomorrow we'll take a look at using the Power Pivot tab and creating some additional calculations. So all of this is possible. It's when we want to insert a calculated field, that's when you have to pay the extra $2 a month to get the Pro Plus version of Office 365. Well, hey, thanks to Rob Colley from Power Pivot Pro for this tip, and thanks to you for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another netcast from Mr. Excel.